just need my one-on-one time with you, you, with no interruptions.
What's going on, world? Y'all tuning in to my very first episode of my web series, Breaking the Cycle, where we're going to be focusing on right believing, better living, and better decisions. This series is in no way, shape, or form to bring attention to me or my music. What inspired me to do this is everything I've been through in my life. The ups and downs, the ins and outs, and how I'm being blessed now beyond measure. I don't claim to be no know-it-all at all. You know, everything that I learned is through process of elimination. You know, I did the wrong thing so many times. It just led me to learn how to understand how to do the right things. You know, I've been a teenage father. I've used drugs. I sold drugs. I had my back to the wall for the majority of my life. And not only did I get tired of living like that, but I didn't want my kids to follow in my footsteps. But I know in all reality that they more likely to do what I do than to do what I say. And that's scary for me. My goal with this series is to be an inspiration to somebody, to give somebody guaranteed hope that, you know, to give somebody guaranteed hope to many people as possible. To someone out there who want a better life for themselves and their kids. For someone who's going through a legal situation that seems like a dead end. Maybe for somebody with an illness that can't see no light at the end of the tunnel. It could be somebody out there contemplating suicide, feel like there's nothing else to live for. It could be a single parent, somebody out there dealing with abuse, molestation, drug addiction. It could be a financial situation. Your lights could be cut off, you've no food in your refrigerator, you don't know where your next meal coming from, whatever it may be. You know, I dealt with majority of those situations myself, or somebody close to me has. What I'm telling you today is, you know, regardless of what you face with today, you know, I know the answer to your situation, and his name is Jesus Christ. That might sound far-fetched, you might not believe it, because honestly, is at one point I didn't believe it, but we all know, just because you don't believe something don't mean it's true, you know what I mean? What I want to tell you, Jesus is able to break every negative cycle in your life. He had a solution before you had a problem. In 2005, I was diagnosed with a rare skin disease called pemphigus and pemphigoid, you know what I mean? My grandmother, rest in peace to her, she died, she had it. My mother, she, you know, she was battling with it. You know, she had to retire 4 years early from her job. My aunt, she has it. It's a hereditary disease. You know, they prescribed me the medicine prednisone. It's a steroid. It's a steroid which, you know, it doesn't cure disease. There's no cure for the disease, but it just calms down the inflammation. So, you know, you're able to live life, whatever the case may be. But I was in and out of emergency rooms all around the country. You know, I couldn't live a day without this medication. I had to continually take it. I was on a medication for about 4 years. You're only supposed to take low doses of it for 6 months. I was taking high doses of it for 4 years. The medication, it doesn't really, you know, cure the disease, but it keeps the inflammation down. And I really needed it to survive. Everywhere I would go, you know, I needed it. You could ask anybody that know me. They don't prescribe it for a long time because of the side effects of the disease. It hurts your liver and so many other things. So from 2005 and for a few years on, when I was running around with Fab and them, and I was on tour and I was out Vegas with Floyd, you know, I had it. That's why a lot of times my fans would wonder why they wouldn't see me in a while, because I was fighting this illness. You know, it still left marks on my body or whatever the case may be. This would come 24 hours. This was always there every single day for years and years. In 2009, I gave my life to Jesus Christ. About 3 months shortly after I gave my life to Jesus Christ, I went to prison for a drug case that I caught in 2008. Now, while I was in jail, you know, I was taking the medicine or whatever the case may be. I was in jail for about 9 months at the time. And, you know, always in my Bible, getting closer to God, praying or whatever the case may be. On this one particular day, I was in my cell just praying. Medication came around. You know, the guards screamed out, "Medication up," you know what I mean? And they buzzed my door for me to come get my medication. As I'm getting off the floor from praying to go get my medication, I hear a small voice say, "Don't take the medicine." So I look around like, damn, I think it's crazy, you know what I mean? I start walking towards the medication line like, I know I ain't hear that. I need my medicine. I just broke out the day before. So as I'm walking, I get closer to the line, I hear the voice a little louder like, "Don't take the medication." And I knew the voice was the voice of God. So I was kind of nervous, but when I got to the front of the medication line, I told the nurse, I said, you know, I don't want the medication. So she looked at me like crazy, like, listen, well, if you break out, don't get the correctional officer to call down to the hospital later and come down. You don't want to take the medication. We ain't coming back till later, yada, yada, yada. So I'm like, all right. And my cellmate, who was in the cell, my cellie, He come over and walk up to me like I was crazy. He like, damn, big bro, he like, you know, take your medication. He was in it because he the one that got to deal with it if I break out. So I just look at him. I'm like, you know, I heard from God. He looking at me like, you heard from God, like I was crazy. He like, all right, bro. So he, you know, to make a long story short, the next day, somebody was fighting on the block. We locked inside the cell, and it was about 4:30, 5 o'clock. We eating dinner. He hit me up. We talking. He was like, yo, it ain't come back yet. Normally come back almost at least every 12 hours. I start breaking out, whatever the case may be. And I'm like, you know, yeah, I know. I'm looking at it. I couldn't even believe it myself. But to make a long story short, that was 2009. It's 2014 now. It hasn't came back since. The doctors can't explain it. It don't make no sense. But what I come to find out in my Christian walk, that faith don't make no sense. You understand what I'm saying? And, you know, that was nothing but a miracle. So, you know, what I'm telling you is, regardless if you're dealing with a medical situation, give it to God. Don't always check on the doctor's reports. You know, check on the head doctor's report. You know, now while I'm still in jail, whatever the case may be, I did 2 years in New Jersey State Prison. I had a detainer from Philadelphia for a charge that I caught back in the day. In 2008, I got put on 4 years probation in Philadelphia in a courtroom. This is actually the first time I met Meek Mill. You know, he happened to be in the same courtroom that I was in Philly. So I met Meek, whatever the case may be. The judge sentenced me to 4 years probation. Now, the judge was real stern because he was actually giving me a break for the case that I caught. He said, listen, don't come back in front of me for no violation, because any violation, any way you violate is going to result in state confinement. I mean, technical violation, direct violation, whatever you do. So now I'm in court, this new case right after that, new drug case, and I ran on him. I was out Vegas running around with Floyd and all them. Now since I got caught up for my other charge, I did 2 years. I get back to Philly about 2011. I got parole from the state. They moved me down here to Philly. So now when I get down to Philadelphia, I got a lawyer, his name is Anthony Patron. You know, he came to see me on State Road at the jail. He looked at the violation report that my probation officer, Ms. Cabazzoli, sent me, and it says, the judge says that any violation that I had will result in state confinement. So when he looked at the, he said, listen, I'm gonna see what I gotta do, but the judge wrote a stipulation on there. It ain't too much we can do. I'm constantly praying to God, because I just came from state, praying. And you know, I heard from God, that same voice that told me not to take the medication. God was like, listen, I'm gonna take care of you. You know, and it seemed kind of impossible because I'm looking at the situation. He said any violation will result in state confinement. Not only did I have one violation, I had two violations. So, you know, time get closer and closer. I'm praying. We're about 2 days away from me seeing my court date. I called the probation officer who violated me, Ms. Cabazzoli, try to soften her heart up, and she was basically, she wasn't trying to hear it. She like, listen, I'm gonna go in front of the judge. You the one that did it. Now you wanna call me crying, whatever the case may be. And you know, so that made me nervous. Still, even though God told me he had me, but I'm looking in a physical what the situation was. So you know, I called my mom on the phone, like telling the situation. My mom is a great woman of faith. So I'm talking to my mom on the phone. She like, listen, what do you want to eat that night? You coming home? I'm like, mom, I'm like, listen. I tell her the situation. She said, Jeffrey, what do you want to eat? So, you know, I tell her whatever the case may be, not believing. Make a long story short, the next day, I go to court. I'm in the holding cell behind the judge's chambers. Two other dudes in there with me. They two other guys in there with me. They got to see the judge as well for violation. One dude go before me, judge smoking, 3 years. Next dude go. He gets smoked for about 3 to 4 years. So now I'm the third dude that gotta go in. Judge already mad. You know, I already got stipulations written on me, whatever the case may be. So I walk in the courtroom, bailiff bring me in the courtroom. I'm scanning the room to look for the probation officer. I don't see her face. I sit behind a chair, and next thing you know, a man stood up that I never seen. He was a representative, a substitute for her, because he just stood up and told the judge, well, look, Mr. Cabazzoli got sick today. And I'm just looking around like, God, sick. I'm like, you know, I knew it was nothing but God. And, you know, he started reading the report of what happened. But obviously, he wouldn't read it as if she would read it. So after he was done reading everything that I'd done, both violations, the judge asked the prosecutor. He asked the prosecutor, he said, did I write anything, stipulate anything down for him? And which was an alley-oop, I thought was sarcastic, because he's sitting with the paperwork right in front of him. He see that he wrote, any violation will result in state confinement. I'm sitting in front of this man with two violations. So I just knew I was over. Then he asked the prosecutor. And if anybody don't know what a prosecutor is, their job is to prosecute you, to send you to jail for the full extent of the law. So, you know, I'm just waiting to hear what she gonna say, 5 years, 10 years. Next thing you know, she come out of her mouth and say, yes, you did, but you know, I don't suggest we send him to state prison. So now I look around, you know, I'm thinking I'm hearing things, I'm thinking I'm getting punked or something, you know, but I knew it was nothing but God. So then, you know, the judge said, well, you know, I don't know who on your side or whatever the case may be, but you know, you got something working for you. What he did was he revoked my probation. He took back my 4 years of probation and he gave me 3 more years of probation. And I came home that day. So what I'm trying to tell you, what looked impossible in the physical, you know what I mean, it looked impossible in the physical, it was possible with the supernatural. With God, all things are possible. You understand what I'm saying? I was faced with two situations, and those are just two situations that I chose to speak about that God blessed me with out of countless situations that he performed in my life. And he didn't just do that for me. It wasn't just for me. I was blessed to be a blessing, to tell somebody out there that's faced with an impossible situation that Jesus will make a way out of no way. But what I want to tell you, just as real as Jesus is, hell is just as real. You know what I mean? And forever is a long time. So it's your choice you got to make. Your grandmother can't take you to heaven with her. Stop caring about what people think. God don't want to change your personality. He just want to change some of your characteristics. We all need God in our life. And Jesus is the only way. So if you never accepted Jesus Christ in your life as your Lord and Savior, in a minute on the screen, a sinner's prayer gonna come up on the screen. We believe if you confess with your mouth and believe with your heart that you will be saved. There's a spiritual war going on here and you gotta choose sides. We always think we got to tomorrow to make things right, but we always heard the saying, tomorrow is not promised. Well, I came to tell you today, in fact, today is not even promised. Here today, gone today. I'm not here trying to sell you no t-shirts, no hats. I'm not asking you for a donation. What I got is not 50% off. It's not 75% off. It's free to you. You know, Jesus Christ paid for it, but it's free to you. Just remember, y'all, it's not about religion. It's about relationship. It's about that one-on-one time with your Creator. Don't forget that. Until next time, y'all. Oh.
Down on my knees, waiting.